Welcome again to ASA Forum 2019 under the theme Living Green. My name is Pichayut Vacharatvikom and I will be your master of ceremony for this session. If you missed the first session from Big this morning or from the sessions from yesterday, you will be able to access the recorded videos on ASA online soon. Just a reminder, if any of you have any questions during the presentation, please do not hesitate to let our staff know. They will be running around the room with a pen and paper ready. This session is a little unique because our speaker is not an architect, but coming from a very interesting consulting practice focusing on sustainability and environmental design called Atelier Ten. With a strong vision to shape a more sustainable world, Atelier Ten has over 28 years experience assisting design teams around the world to continue pushing and envelope and incorporate innovative design strategies. Please join me to welcome Nico, Kienzl.
Thank you so much for inviting me to speak today. As was just presented, I'm not a practicing architect. I actually trained as an architect in my earlier life. But we are Atelier Ten, I'm part of Atelier Ten, and we are a firm that has a different profile that has emerged in the last two decades. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about who we are and what we do to give you a context and to make it clear that all of the beautiful images of architecture that you're going to see as part of this presentation, the projects we have supported but not designed as a designer. And then I will want to talk about some of the things that we see currently in the world affecting this topic of sustainability and green design, which we think is a really pressing issue, and that there's a lot of our work that I think that is relevant to the market here, but also to, I think, larger issues the profession faces. So here we go. So Atelier Ten started 25 years ago as a mechanical engineering practice in the UK, founded by an engineer who came through the kind of like over Arrow Burr Happel school of thinking to always think about architecture and engineering being integrated and be basically of one vision. And we've grown over the years into a firm that is now 250 people strong with 10 offices around the world, one here in Bangkok for almost 10 years now, but have managed to keep a vision of working very, very closely, because one of the richness we see in having this global reach is that we can learn from each other and really, as Kai was saying before, implement the best ideas and transfer them between our various offices and our various projects. And so that's some of the role we're playing. But fundamentally, the core vision and mission of the firm is to shape a more sustainable world. And our goal really is to help designers and owners to understand what the environmental ramifications are of the design decisions that they're making. And finding a way of integrating design thinking and engineering around the vision of sustainability and move that forward. And it's all about, for us, because a lot of us, like myself, started originally as architects, about the built environment. Sustainability will touch every aspect of our lives, where you buy your toothpaste and how you're going to dispose of your trash. But we are really passionate about buildings. We're really interested in thinking about how the spaces, the buildings, the cities we're in can evolve into something that is really delightful and heighten our spirits, but also at the same time they're really performance-driven. And so we have a couple of principles that have really guided our work. One of them is that we want the building itself and the landscapes to do more so that the systems in the building, the HVAC systems, the energy systems, need to do less. Not only allows us to do more energy efficient buildings and more resource efficient buildings, but it also allows us to be more innovative with the systems that we deploy. Because typically a building that relies on heavy conditioning, on very high loads, you're going to get more and more limited to the type of system that you can use. Whereas the building already does most of the work, there's a much wider range of tools you can use to achieve your needs. And then always question, what is it that we're really trying to achieve here? And go back to first principle. What does the architecture want to do? What's the climate that we're in? What's the fundamental function that the space needs to fulfill? So that we then can come up with creative new ideas instead of like just doing what engineers have been taught to do for fee pressure reasons for many years now, which is pull the last project out of the drawer and just size the ducts over for the new one. But to really think creatively about what can happen then and really integrate ourselves into the design process and to solutions. A lot of our compatriots in the engineering world are starting really when the architecture is finished. And we think that's a fundamentally wrong approach. What we want to do is we want to be part of the process from day one, and luckily have been able to build a firm and a brand where people invite us to be part of the competition, part of the initial submission, so we can have a conversation about what the building wants to be for a certain program, for a certain climate, before the pen hits the paper for the first time. And then it's all about being pragmatic. A lot of our clients are institutional clients because these are naturally the ones that are having a long-term interest in their work and in their buildings. And they often are the ones that don't have a lot of money then to pay for expensive upkeeps of really advanced, complex systems. And so we try to do things where the building continues to perform well, even if one of the widgets that is in the building breaks. It doesn't rely on like the latest Swiss design shading automation system or something like that, that you have a hard time maintaining. And so we found that this approach translates very well to many clients in many places around the world. So we then ask them, like, okay, so that's all great, but what do you actually do, right? And so this is kind of like the long and evolving laundry list of things we help clients with. At the forefront is environmental design, which is really something that is kind of a made-up term that started emerging 15 years ago to capture this idea of literally helping architects think about not only what is the environmental footprint of the buildings that they're creating also, but also what is really the environment that they're creating. And we think that the environmental experience that you have in a building is shaping your overall experience of building as much as lighting, as much as the architectural shapes and colors and the materials that you're in. So whether you're hot or you're cold, whether how you transition from one space to the other, a lot of this is environmental design. And then we do all kinds of other things, primarily MEP engineering still out of our London office, and a lot of other optimization things that are just various buckets that have evolved over time with changing client needs. Recently, a lot more to do with questions of how do we deal with healthy buildings, how do we looking at benchmarking, but all of them are just supporting this larger mission. And one way of describing what we're doing is we do invisible architecture. We do the stuff that people typically don't see because it's hidden behind walls, or it's the fact that you're actually sitting in the shade of a beautifully designed shading device. And so we actually put it together in a book called Invisible Architecture a couple of years ago, to kind of like communicate this ethos. So as you can imagine, it makes it a little bit hard to do a PowerPoint presentation about things you can't see. So I will do my best showing what we do on the examples of the work that we've been fortunate to do over the last couple of years. And as I said, it's a wide range of projects. The beauty about being a consultant is that you can touch many projects because you ask for your strategic input and your smart thinking, and you can bring this to a wide number of projects. And so one of the things that people come to us for is the fact that we can kind of like give them a great overview of what's happening right now in the market, what is happening, what is possible technologically, globally, and what applies to their project. So you see here, this is just a snapshot of some of the recent work we've been doing here in Asia, in the region. I'll touch on some of these projects. But this is, it's just a tiny snapshot of the huge range of projects that we've been seeing. So what is driving our work? Why are we doing this? Why do we care? So we firmly believe that climate change is the defining challenge of our times. It is the big question. And while there's a lot of political noise around it, we do think that this is something that we need to address as a society or face incredibly dire consequences along the lines what Kai mentioned in his earlier talks. Even more so, we have an ever-closing window to address this. If you look at the latest IPCC report, basically we have 10 years, which in the construction industry is basically nothing, to make a major, major change in how we think about buildings and cities and operate them. Because if you're not able to maintain this, forgot that I have a laser pointer that's like would make Darth Vader proud. If we're not able to stay within this 1.5 degree threshold, all kinds of bad things will happen, including, as Kai was pointing out today in his earlier talk, sea level rise that affects where major population areas live, with all kinds of social and economic implications. But we don't even have to actually wait the next 10 years. The bad stuff is already happening. If you look at the increase in climate events and the frequency in which extreme events are happening, we're already seeing the impact of climate change today, which has the positive side effect that it started to focus people's attention and mind on how bad this could be if we miss this mark. And even the big insurance companies who are starting to shell out money to pay for some of these insured losses are starting to really drum the drumbeat of, like, this is going to be bad unless we act very, very decisively and quickly. And you've seen this locally. I mean, this is just one example. I know you had this earlier in the year, the impact of air quality, bad air quality through to higher pollution. That's an environmental impact that has affected every one of you. And I think it's these kinds of things, even if they're short-lived at the moment, are really heightening the awareness of everybody of things to come and of the urgency with which we need to act. And it's really not going to, it's not going to affect economic well-being and so on, but it's really going to affect potentially the health of us and our children. So there's a great urgency to act. And luckily, we are now in a place where we see around the world progressive policies are starting to be put in place to address this. And I'm just picking New York because that's, the one that I'm most familiar with because I'm out of our New York office, but also because we've been in a very fortunate place in New York. We've, as you might have heard in the news, we had a very progressive mayor, Mayor Bloomberg, who's fundamentally a data guy. And so what he did around 15 years ago now, 17 years ago, started to really track a lot of the data in the city about where's the energy going, what are the greenhouse gas emissions, and so on, which allowed the city then not only to understand the urgency, but also model out the potential policy levers and strategies that they need to put into place to actually have a meaningful impact. And so New York City now had a series of policy documents that have emerged over the last 10 years or so about setting the city on a on a sustainable path, on a path that ultimately will be sustainable, of 80% of greenhouse gas reduction by 2050. So that is a massive drop in emissions from a 2005 benchmark to achieve what is then considered to be a level of emissions that we can sustain. And even more so, because of all of the data we have, we can actually not only say we want an 80% reduction, but we can actually say, what does it actually mean? Where does our carbon emissions come? Where do our carbon emissions come from? How much of it is transportation? And in New York City, most of it is buildings, which makes it so interesting for our profession. And so how do we get from here to there, understanding where our energy comes from? And we can map out exactly where the energy for a city like New York comes from and what are the associated CO2 emissions. And so this gives us a great way of kind of like being really rational and performance driven. It also shows us how it's going to be incredibly hard, because if you look at what the emission profile of the electrical grid around New York City is, you can model out and say realistically by 2050 how much greener will the grid be, an ideal scenario where we can add a lot of renewables, or if we green our grid slower, where it might be, or what some of the potential real challenges are happening, which is in this case actually the fact that we're going to have to shut down one of our nuclear power plants that's close to New York City, and actually our carbon emissions are going to go up in the short term. So these things are all things we understand very well, and it allowed the city to develop, with input from firms like ours, a plan that says we're going to have future growth because the city is a living organism that's going to keep on growing. So what are all of these things that we need to do to get down to this number? And my talk today is going to touch on some of them, but a key one is to basically start looking at ways of improving energy efficiency, because there's not one silver bullet that's going to just make this all go away, but it's many steps. But one of them is to start looking at improvements to the energy codes to basically improve new buildings, electrify existing buildings so that we can make the existing buildings run off at some point, hopefully more and more low energy, low carbon power that comes from the grid. So that's the only way we can wean ourselves from fossil fuels to that low target. So it's a multitude of things: efficiency, electrification, greening of the grid. And this is fundamentally universal. This is the same thing that's going to have to happen at various degrees in different cities. The only difference is some cities, like Bangkok, you're further along on the electrification of buildings, because you're luckily in a climate where you don't have a high heating demand, so you don't burn lots of natural gas to heat your buildings. You're already far along on the score of making electric buildings. But all of these things need to come together. And so what this results in is policies at various levels. One of them is the idea that our energy codes are going to get more and more stringent. So this ESRE 90.1, which is the U.S. standard for energies that a lot of the cities and international agencies adopt for energy efficiency, that has dropped in terms of typical energy intensity by more than 60% since the 1980s. So it's been going way down, and the trajectory is that this is going to get more and more constraining. So a lot of our clients are just simply dealing with the fact that the codes, the requirements for new buildings are getting tougher and tougher to meet, and they still want to do great architecture. So how do you actually start doing these high-performance buildings? The other thing, and this is a big one, and it has just happened a week ago, is we're going to need to look at the entire existing building stock as well. So if you look at a city like New York, you can have kind of like a plot where you see what's the carbon emission intensity of the entire building stock, which is millions and millions of square feet. How do you get all of this to reduce its energy footprint? And so the city, just in the last week and a half, made this massive step that I think a lot of cities will follow and will have to follow soon, which is basically they're establishing hard carbon emission caps for all buildings over a certain size. So this affects 60% of all square footage, new and existing, in New York City. And it basically says you cannot emit more than this amount of CO2 per square foot. And not only is that target for 24, but it actually is going to step down in 2030 to a lower number, and it tells you where you will need to be by 2050. So there's a architect should be very happy, and engineers, because there's going to be tons of work in existing buildings to get all of these buildings upgraded. It also carries a real stick, meaning that there is a real dollar per ton of emissions applied if you miss that target. So we now have clients in energy-intensive buildings who potentially look at million-dollar penalties a year of missing the emission targets on existing buildings. And there's a lot of discussion about innovative ways of potentially trading carbon between buildings. How do you do offset with renewables and so on? But this is, as John Mandyke said, the largest disruption in the New York City's real estate that we have seen. And I think it's what you will see everywhere around the world sooner or later, because this is the stuff that needs to happen for us to move towards these lower energy benchmarks and emission benchmarks. So in a way, this is the stick, right? This is the stuff that policy will need to drive us to in order to make this happen. But I do think I want to take a different approach today in the talk and talk about what I think we as architects should, what role we should play. And I've been quite inspired by Christina Figueres, who was the woman who was really in charge of making sure that the Paris Climate Accord was signed. And she had this great quote when she had accepted an award in New York last year, where she thinks what we need is stubborn optimism that we can deal with this challenge. And she defines stubborn optimism as optimism because nothing good ever came out of a negative, like, downtrodden attitude. You gotta be positive and think we're gonna manage this if we ever want to get there. But you're also going to be stubborn because it's going to be hard. It's going to be not easy. It's going to require a lot of change. There's going to be a lot of obstacles. So we need to have the grit to stick to our guns and say, no, this needs to happen. We need to stay with this, and we cannot just put our head in the sand and pretend it's all going to be fine. But it needs to be coming from a point of we can make this a better world in the process. So I want to show some of the things that we've been trying to do in our work to take this stubborn optimism into the real world. So I'm going to talk about five topics that I think hopefully at the end you will realize how they build on each other as some of the things that we are very excited to see and that we're doing. So one of them is climate design. So if we think about how we want to make a building go from a conventional design to an ultimately net zero carbon positive building, the first step has to always be understand the climate that you're in and design a building in terms of its massing, in terms of its building envelope, in terms of its passive systems to respond to the climate. And there are a great ways we can do this now, both in terms of technologies of building the buildings, but also more and more in which we can analyze the impact of the performance ahead of time to build our argument. So here's a couple of examples of how we have done this. This is a building for the federal government in the United States. It's a new 400,000 square foot, 40,000 square meter office building in Florida. It's actually the FBI headquarters for the Southern District of Florida. And so it's an office building for an institutional client. And the architects and us developed this rationale with the owners that we say, fundamentally, the architecture should be there for the lifetime of the building. And if you think about an institutional government building, you really want to plan for 100-year life of that building. That building should be there for a while. The building enclosure, the curtain wall, the roofs, all of this really should have a very long service life. And some of the technologies that go into the systems, whether they're the lighting, the HVACs, those are the things that have a shorter life cycle because technology changes and gets replaced. And especially some of the newer energy systems and so on are getting replaced much more quickly or starting to because they see more technological change currently. Interestingly, the cost of operation maintenance is kind of like the reverse of the pyramid, right? Once you build the building right and sited it right, you don't really have to do a lot to it anymore. It's going to stay there. Whereas the kind of like the systems you put in are the ones that are needing maintenance operation. So in a way, spending money on this is the smartest investment you can do on your buildings. And so building this rationale, we worked with the GSA and the architects to say, okay, so we had the advantage of a fairly large site, partly because the building, for security reasons, needed to be set back from the perimeter for bomb protection, all this stuff. And so we said, okay, let's fundamentally question of how we want to orient the building and quantify how a building that sits along the east-west orientation is inherently better from a solar radiation standpoint, meaning how much solar the facade hits that we then need to cool down in a warm climate in Florida. And so we quantify that very early on. We can also then say, okay, so if we do this building that now runs east-west, because we know that's better from a solar gain standpoint generally, we also know that our worst solar gain is the east and west facade with low angle sunlight. And so what happens if we do our massing so that all the stair towers, all of the things that don't really need a lot of daylight, and we could do fairly solid facades go into the east and west so that we can leave the north and south facades open for daylighting? And how about we then, instead of building your typical deep floor office building, we cut this building in half and shift it apart so we get 260 to 70 feet bars that are really having beautiful daylight so that we can switch off the lights most of the time. So building this rationale allowed us to make an argument for building that basically is two narrow long buildings running east-west, connected through a bridge element in the entrance, sitting on this landscape, and really thinking about the fundamental massing of the building. It also allowed us, because of the setbacks and so on, to re-green the rest of the site and actually bring the kind of like native Everglade landscape into that landscape. We're actually using the wetlands as part of our barrier for security standpoint because they're deep enough that you can actually drive a vehicle through them. And so we're creating a landscape that responds to the local context in terms of its water management and stormwater management while meeting all of its functional requirements in a quite compact form. And one of the big hopes there was that when we create this beautiful kind of like natural landscape is that people obviously want to have not only daylight but also views and connection to this. So how do you make a building that is quite transparent in a warm and solar climate but preserves the view? So one of the strategies, because we now basically only have the south facade to deal with from a solar gain standpoint, and because of the way the sun moves over the site, we only deal with very high angle sunlight, we were able to create a shading grid that follows the shape of the facade that allows some daylight into the building in kind of like the winter months when it's cool outside and the solar heat gain is really not a significant problem for us. But it fundamentally, once spring comes around, completely shades this glass facade. And in this climate, we can do a glass facade because we're not worried about heat loss because it's mild outside, so we're not heating the building. But we can keep all of the solar gains off the facade so that we see a drastic reduction in our cooling load. And so what this did is that we created a building, and we actually were able to go back and do all of the post-occupancy verification and measure the building with light meters and photography, where we get a building that 70% of this floor plate is daylit, and 60% achieves daylight autonomy. Daylight autonomy means that it meets the requirements for workplace during office hours completely without any electric lighting. So you now have a building in a climate that has beautiful views through like floor-to-ceiling glass, it's beautifully daylit, but it's also effectively totally shaded. So this goes similar to what Kai was presenting earlier for this project in Shenzhen, I think. It's basically a really rethinking of climate-appropriate architecture with modern toolkit of a curtain wall, and actually in this case, a blast-proof curtain wall that has all kinds of security requirements. And it allows us to design a building that drastically reduces energy use over code, because our cooling loads really significantly reduces. And we were actually able to install a large amount of PV arrays, of photovoltaics on the parking and support structures so that we have a building that meets 16% of its energy demand on site and is an all-electric building that if the federal government, as they start doing, buys renewable power through the grid, can be a net zero building. So this is, by the definition of the federal government, a net zero ready building. And it's a beautiful building. It's a building where the architecture, I think, really talks about what you want to design in this climate. And by being able to do this only on one facade, you can really spend your money on that shade and keep the rest of the building quite straightforward and simple, if Wavy's curtain walls are simple. But it's a building that I think speaks very well to this idea of climate-appropriate design in a warm and humid climate. Now, in a different climate, your strategy might be very different. So we're working right now with shop architects on the new headquarters for Uber, the ride-sharing company in San Francisco. And there we are in a climate that is very, very mild. And fundamentally, you could be outside without air conditioning most of the year. And so the desire here was to do a building that connects to the neighborhood and connects the staff to this beautiful climate, by basically not air conditioning, but naturally ventilating a significant part of the building. So the design team and us developed a strategy where there's this solarium idea where you can enter the building one side and basically walk like on an outdoor plaza through the building all the way up to the top through space that's only naturally ventilated, and it's protected from rain through a glass screen, but it's basically not air conditioned. And so the challenge with this is that if you spend hundreds of millions on dollars on a new building, you obviously want to make sure that it's actually going to work. And a lot of the tools are not ready to do this yet. So this was an exercise where we actually built custom tools to map hot and cold discomfort on a spatial level on annual modeling of solar gain and temperatures throughout the space. So we can say, okay, if you only do like an open glass screen. It's a glass screen that's naturally ventilated behind to get air movement through. Are you going to be comfortable? We realized that there are enough hours in the year when you're just outside that comfort level because you might be in direct sun. So the temperature, the air temperature is right, but you're not, it's a little bit warm when you're standing directly in the sun. And there are some hours in the winter where you actually want that solar gain. So we were able to model this and instead develop a catalog of different strategies, whether they are vertical shades, whether they are increasing the airflow or reducing the airflow in the cavity to take more or less advantage of the outside temperature, and really model out how we can start getting these more and more of the hours in the year into this comfort band, and so that we then can really model up how this heat stress with multiple different strategies, whether they're simple light shelves or shades or actually plantings in the building that create local shaded zone, allow you to get a place that is outside, but better than outside because you're not in the rain when it rains, and allow people to go through this building or spill out of the conditioned office floor to have a meeting out there or have a chat with people and get a moment of respite. And so this catalog of strategies is then flexibly deployed based on what each space needs and can be designed for this. And some of this is static, like fixed shading elements. Some of this is dynamic, like fan operation song. But there's no active cooling in this space. And this has actually been a really big challenge because the code officials aren't familiar with this. So you actually needed to go through them and demonstrate to them that we will not air condition the space, and we don't have to, and we never will. As a result, all of this building envelope should not be part of our energy calculations because we're not going to spend any energy in this space, and our thermal envelope really starts back here. And so it took months of negotiation with the authorities to get this approved. Furthermore, what we did is we said, okay, so this is great. We know what the climate was in the last 10 years. We looked at climate data and so on, but we know the climate is changing. So how are we actually going to, if you spent this kind of money in a building, how sure can you be that this is actually going to work into the future? So what we did is we modeled not only current climate, but we modeled future climate scenarios. And so now data sets where you can look at different scenarios for global warming, and you can get data sets that look at hourly temperature profiles in 2050, and you can see, okay, so it's going to be roughly a doubling of days when you're going to be slightly discomfortable in this space. Is that acceptable to an owner and a client? In this case, it was. Because, again, it was a transitional space that allowed people to move around in it. But I think this is becoming a more and more important tool to be able to say, it's like, what's happening in these spaces? So this is how the space is rendered. And I'm realizing I need to speed up a lot in order to get through this material. Going through a local project then, taking the same approach to this climate, this is the first project Nari and I worked on here in Bangkok. It's the Magnolias Rajdhani Boulevard Tower. It's a building that, as you know, the site has a great view, and the desire to really preserve that view was paramount. And so at the same time, we wanted to do an energy efficient building. So we are able now to model and map out how much solar gain do we see on which orientation on this site, and how do we can we set targets for solar load reductions in various orientation for this building. So we developed a matrix where we said in the shape of the tower, which facades on the upper and lower floors have a higher or lesser degree of need for shading to meet our energy targets. And then what are the ways by which we could do this with overhangs, with vertical fins, with horizontal fins, with things that have certain translucency, and basically model a catalog of all of these strategies in all of these orientations to basically develop a roadmap where if you have lots of reds, it's most probably not the right strategy for this building. But there are things where you see it. Certain things worked in one orientation, didn't work well in another. And so this led to this idea of a strategy where the facade changes by orientation as you move up in the building, which worked well with this idea of an architecture that really mimics this idea of a flower and petals that are unfurling around the height of the building. And so taking inspiration from nature here, we worked on implementing a shading strategy that went from something, from areas where we knew a horizontal overhang is going to be better for us because of the sun angles we have there, to something where actually a vertical screen is giving us more shading. And so it allowed us to play with a language that had this idea of a soft, curving, changing facade throughout the building. And again, quantifying this and demonstrating this to the design team and the owners. And then even play with the degree of perforation while preserving the all-important views out and down into the urban landscape. And so the idea here was that you could have a building in Bangkok that is fully glazed, that has preserved these magnificent views, but at the same time meets all of its solar gain objectives. So it's a slightly different take on what Kai was showing in terms of how the shading is organized about the building. But again, it preserves transparency where you can have it, and it directs the views in areas where you want to create shading. And this went down to the kind of like the translation and to changing perforation patterns, again, based on the amount of solar control we needed and to communicate to a client that even like at a shade that is 50% shaded, you still get a large amount of view through that shade, and that this is actually acceptable. So in the end, sorry, something went wrong with the fonts here. We got a pretty significant reduction in energy savings due to the fact that we control solar gain so efficiently. And what was really rewarding is to see the building at the end of the day so much being true to some of the very earliest renderings in terms of the architectural language that the architects had in mind, but now being completely performance-driven. And you actually create a surface that you then can use for projection and so on. So instead of having lights integrated in the facade, you actually now have this varied facade that gives us a richness that you can then use for other things. So all of these are ways of thinking about the climatic response that might be quite different in different climates. Now we said climate design is one, but we know we need to condition the buildings, and we need to figure out how to do this without fossil fuels. And so one of the first steps is to make the building all electric, and we've done projects like the Frick Environmental Center in Pittsburgh, where the building meets its own energy demand by having photovoltaics on site. And actually, this building is energy positive. It produces more energy over the course of the year than it uses, and it meets all of these other benchmarking criteria. But in a way, it's fairly easy, in quotation mark, to do this on a smaller visitor center. It gets a lot harder when you do this on a building here, like the Kola Environmental Center in Connecticut, where we now have laboratories and classrooms and greenhouses. But as long as you have enough site area, you can still do this and start creating a building that fundamentally meets its own energy demand. When you start looking at a building where you are more site-constrained and you build up more, it becomes more difficult. So, for example, our Kroon Hall project at Yale. This is now a four-story academic building in a more urban campus. The goal here was also to be a building that is all electric and light in its environmental footprint. So again, you start with understanding the daylight so you can design a facade. In this case, one that is a much more punched window facade to get you the right amount of glazing by minimizing heat gain and maximizing daylight in the building. You design your special facades like the east and west facade here, and especially for the upstairs reading room with external shading to control your solar gain. So you start still with the climate appropriate design, but then you start looking at what you have to work with or what you can work with in the building. And again, because now you have a building that has relatively small loads because it's well insulated, well shaded, you can now activate things like an underfloor air system that it's much gentler in terms of its conditioning energy. You can actually use the thermal mass of the exposed concrete slab to deal with day and night temperature swings. And you can design a building that for the spring and autumn in this climate is completely naturally ventilated. So the systems go off, and you can open the windows, and you can just vent out and get ventilation through the windows. But you do know that in the Connecticut climate, you're going to have to cool in the summer, and you have to heat in the winter. And to do this all electric in this urban context here, we ended up going to a ground source heat pump system. So we don't have cooling towers or condenser units outside. We're just engaging actively with the ground to make this happen. So you end up with a ground source heat pump system, all electric, and then you really think about how you trick out your air handling units to take advantage of heat recovery, adiabatic cooling, all of these good things to maintain high indoor air quality without spending a lot of energy on it. And then you integrate as much renewables on the project as you can. So in this project, really our opportunities were on the roof and to a certain extent in the facades. So we have these integrated solar panels on the roof. We actually, for demonstration purposes more than anything, have solar hot water heaters in the facade that use the solar energy to heat the little bit of domestic hot water that we have. And all of this is driven by rigorous energy analysis so that we can advise clients on what's the benefit of the amount of energy that we're using in terms of the strategies that we're suggesting. So there's intense quantification in terms of energy use. And what it allows us to do with having these numbers is not only to advise on life cycle cost, but it allows us to go back when the building opens and help the clients to say, are you actually operating the building as it's intended to be? And so here at Kroon Hall, what happened is the building actually didn't perform as well as we thought it would be. So when they started it up, the building used around 45% more energy than we anticipated, which is what everybody then says, yes, energy modeling is no good, and why do we do all of this? But the truth of the matter, it's actually a really powerful tool to then figure out what is going wrong. And even with the best commissioning and so on, you can realize that either the controls contractor or the operators are making a mistake in how to run these buildings efficiently. And so we were able to use the tool to then go back and help Yale tune the building and to actually bring it exactly where we should be. And so I think this is a real strong argument for using these tools as an ongoing tool later on in the process, which is, if you go back to the fact that in New York City you're now going to pay for your carbon emissions, is something we are going to have to live with, because suddenly people will be intensely interested in how the building performs over time, and you as the architect and the engineers will be part of that process. So you end up with a very high performance, beautiful building that then not only delights but performs well and meets all of these criteria. So we've done all of this, and this is great, and we think this is a path forward, net zero building, yay, all good. But actually what's changing is how we think about what's happening on the electrical grid, because all of these buildings assume that you produce your own electricity when you can, and if you have excess, you push it back out into the grid, and if you need more, you get it out of the grid, and so over the course, you're net zero, and that's great. Except it's not. Because what we're seeing is when you really start looking how the grid is changing, especially in places where you have more and more renewable power, is that actually the way your building energy uses and how dirty your grid is, how much CO2 emissions you have, those don't necessarily align. And so what we see emerging is what's called the duck curve. So what's happening is that during the night when there's no solar, in a place like California that relies heavily on solar, you still run fossil fuel plants. During the day, all of this new solar power that is either mounted on buildings or in large solar plants are reducing this. It's going to reduce it more and more and more. So you're reducing your demand during the middle of the day, but then the sun goes down and everybody goes home and switches on their TV and starts cooking dinner and runs the dishwasher, and actually you're right where you started or higher in terms of fossil fuel demands, because what you have now is that all of this stuff needs to be met by the electrical grid. So all of these power plants are going to go full tilt back in the early evening. So this duck curve is a real challenge for us, because if we say, well, net zero is great, we actually could be and are in California already at a point where we're producing power, where we're producing power that nobody needs and still have to run all of our fossil fuel plants at night. So what's changing in our attitude is instead of going the old way where we said, okay, we know how much energy use we have in the building. Sorry, the funds all got screwed up. How much energy we use in the building over the course of a year or part of a month, we multiply it with this with an emissions factor. This gives us our total emissions. That doesn't really work anymore unless you have very detailed information on when you use that energy and what's the CO2 profile of your grid at that moment. So once you start doing this, you actually realize that the right amount of solar needs to be paired with some form of energy storage so that you start flattening out the duck curve. And so what you're trying to do is, because what's happening right now is that we get lots of solar energy during the middle of the day, actually more than our demand is, so this is overproduced solar, and then in the afternoon when it goes, the solar goes down, we're now running all of these and often very inefficient plants. And so what we're trying to do now is take this energy and move it over here. And so what that means is an increased push for the need for storage on projects. So one of the projects we're doing this right now is the California College of Arts in San Francisco with Studio Gang. This is a new an extension of an arts college in San Francisco. Has lots of maker spaces and kind of like art production spaces, which has its own challenge because a big part of our energy demand is actually in the glass furnaces that are used to melt glass for the art production. So what we're doing is we're doing all of the good stuff. We're doing a building that is allows for natural ventilation. We shade it well. We do passive cooling, all of these things to drive our demand down. We have all electric systems. But what we're doing now is we're adding a lot of photovoltaics to the project so that we're creating our own energy. And then instead of what we typically would have done, which is use energy when we can and shift the rest to the grid in a net kind of net metering kind of setup, we're now starting to install batteries as part of the project so that we can take the excess energy that we produce during the day and shift that during the night and start hauling this out during the dirtiest time of the grid to greatly reduce our profile. So we, with an actually modest-sized battery, it allows us to really affect this idea of load shifting, not from a cost optimization standpoint, although in California it works out that way too, but from a carbon standpoint. And what's happening there is that we now have hourly data on carbon emissions. So this is what we see on buildings, and it's quite dramatic, the impact that you have, because that's that extra CO2 that you're saving once you add storage to your project, which you otherwise would have still pulled out of the grid. So there's an evolving workflow that really pushes us to less and less operational carbon in buildings, which then leads us to the next topic, which is materials. Because in our projects, we obviously need material to build the buildings, and we need energy to make these buildings. And if you look at the rate in which we're building, you're realizing that this is an enormous amount of material energy that's globally deployed. That number is staggering. If you think about the fact that given the global growth we're looking at in urbanization, you're talking about adding the square footage of a city like New York City to the global building stock every 34 days. So if you think about how much energy goes into making concrete and steel and all of the products, it's a huge issue. And as we make the buildings more efficient, it becomes even bigger so. Because energy is expended every step of the way. You extract it, you make it, you transport it, you build it, you dispose of it. All of this stuff will be a big driver of how we as a profession start looking at materials. And currently, building and construction around 11%, the material side is around 11% of global carbon emissions. Concrete is the majority of that, because concrete is intensely carbon intensive in its manufacture. So as this part of the pie is going to shrink because of better energy codes and all of the things we do on the operation side, the relevance of this is becoming more and more important. What's even more important is if you think about carbon in the atmosphere, we have a limited amount we can emit before all things go really bad. And so the question is how we want to use that amount that we can still emit over the next years. Now the challenge is if you look at operational costs and operational carbon, anything we save is going to slowly accumulate over time, or the slower number in operational energy is accumulating over time to 2050. But the embodied carbon we deploy right now. So if you think about the fact that we have a certain amount of carbon that we can still emit in order in our total profile, addressing the time value of carbon, meaning the fact that we deploy these high carbon intense materials today, is actually more important than just kind of like looking at the life cycle balance of energy and carbon, because there's a real question of when do you use it. And so we're doing this now in projects where we have the tools and we have emerging data sets where we can start. Let's look at an existing building, let's quantify, so we know how much energy we're saving on the operational side. But what's the other side? What's the other material side in terms of carbon emissions? And we can now start looking at by element, like how much do you save if you replace certain additives in your slabs or in your shear walls with something that is better, that because it's a recycled fly ash in your concrete mix or it's a recycled steel. And so you can start figuring out what the relative reduction is you get out of every one of the building envelope. And you can then trace that through the process and say, okay, these are the decisions you can make. This is, again, looking at the major structural elements. How can you start achieving, in this goal, the goal was to get to a 20% reduction in embodied energy. And where is the biggest bang for the buck based on the materials that you have available today? But it's a fundamentally different approach of how we think about the materiality of our buildings. And on the to push this even further, we're trying to encourage the industry and work with the industry to deploy materials in new ways. So, for example, here, this is the largest academic institutional mass timber building in the U.S. now that we've just completed for the University of Massachusetts, where basically the entire structure now of a multi-story academic building becomes mass timber. And the beauty is that we understand these materials now better. We understand the codes of evolving to allow us to do this. But really challenging conventional thinking about what the structural material is allows us to not only dramatically reduce embodied energy, but also create an architecture that starts to have a certain warmth and richness and delight by making these changes visible. So all of this, so we've gotten now from climate design to electric building to materials. All of this is on a building scale. But what's interesting is for us is we see more and more interest in how we deal with this on a larger scale. So I couldn't resist the pun with big plans to start with a big project. Should I say here, actually big, sorry. So we worked with BIC on the master plan for the Smithsonian. The Smithsonian is the national organization that maintains most of the museums in D.C. It's basically the National American Museum Organization. They have a campus of 5 buildings that are all in various stages of need for upgrades, and they hired Bjarke Ingels Group to develop a master plan of how this can be upgraded and integrated. So the idea here, there was a survey of all of the existing buildings and the proposal of how to move forward with them. And so we identified with the team where the various deficiencies are. Some of them were needed roof repair, some of them needed fundamental renovation, some of them, one of the big challenges was that they were all disjointed in terms of the energy strategies. And a big part of doing an energy assessment in this early stage is that it allows you to quantify for a client where the potential savings are and how you can get to something that allows you to become greener in the future. Because that's what ultimately then has to trickle down through long-term capital allocations and often significant changes to the building stock. So we articulated to them where the saving potential is for every one of the building components and how that over time could be integrated into a strategy that ultimately could lead them to a carbon neutral operation of that main campus, including all kinds of energy upgrades, whether they're efficiency upgrades on the energy side in terms of envelopes or HVAC, but also looking at different types of energy generation or green power. And it's very powerful for a client to understand what levers that they have and what they might plan for, what the potential is. In addition to that, Bjarke's group was looking at how to really activate that center, the quad of the project. And so here gets to the point where this is currently sunk into the ground, there's very little daylight, and there's a big effort by the team to really change the perception of this space. And by making a larger intervention there that allowed us to integrate a lot of the HVAC and the mechanical systems we needed to do, needed to integrate there, by also really creating a change in the architecture that brought daylight deep into the space. So the new design now is a sunken museum component that preserved a landscape in between the existing buildings, but created all of these daylight zones that were cut into the floor plate to bring daylight and the sense of daylight down deeper into this. And so I think this is where we can see both strategic long-term planning and passive and active design strategies to create an architecture where the two reinforce each other in a rich architecture that again has a long-term performance benefit. And this is a project that actually won a national award for campus planning because of its innovative approach of bringing all of these things together. And the Smithsonian is now starting to tender the individual pieces. So there's a really important aspect about performance-based design in this one that is about the thinking about design over time, which is what we have to do. Sometimes our studies are very, very abstract, but nonetheless important. So what we see, and we as architects always focus on the new build, but if we have clients, like in our case here, MIT, that has a campus of 150 buildings, and they are now faced with this question, so how are we going to get to carbon emissions reductions? Where should we start? And so this is a campus connected to a central utility plant. What we can now do is basically look at this and say, where's your energy going? How big is your buildings and how energy intensive are these? And so these dots tell you where the energy goes on campus. And you then can model out and figure out how intense is the energy use. And by program type, are you expected that this is so high or something going wrong in this building? Are there opportunities to save energy and we can model this on a building by building scale over the 150 buildings? And say, okay, if you do envelope upgrades, if you do HVAC upgrades, lighting upgrades, what are the savings potentials and what are the potential costs associated so that on a campus level you can do cost-benefit analysis? But what's most important is you can then map this out over time and say, it's not a surprise then for an owner to say, oh, my energy bills went up. But you say, no, wait, we know that you're planning to grow in terms of square footage. We actually know which projects you try to build or come online in the next 15 years. And then we can tell you with various upgrades in your existing campus, how low can you push this? And so that you can start making, both on a CO2 emissions level and on a cost standpoint, you can start making quality and budget allocation decisions so that you can start in a rational way moving forward towards a future climate target. So this is very abstract, but it's actually incredibly powerful because it sets the way up for the future work that all of us are doing. And I think we want to be part of that conversation because we're not just going to raise these campuses. But sometimes we have the opportunity to work from a blank slate. So this is something close in the region. Fulbright University Vietnam is a project we're currently in schematic design in phase one. This is a blank slate university new project for 10,000 students here in your region. And again, it's about this very early integrated thinking that I think is paramount here. So here we were given two sites, one site for the campus and one site for the dormitories. And SHOP, in the beginning as the architects, immediately focus on the fact that this is fundamentally not only a time inefficient way of having students shuttling back and forth between where they live and where they study, making all of these trips, and then actually have to leave the neighborhood because this is more of an industrial park to do, get their food and get their groceries, but that this has an actual real environmental footprint, right? Every time you get on your moped and drive around, it has an impact on energy use and an impact on air quality. And so what came out of this was this idea, let's challenge this, and instead of doing this, let's collapse the campus into an integrated academic and dormitory environment, which was a huge change in Vietnam, where the regulations fundamentally didn't allow you to do this. And it took a lot of arguing about this strategy to allow us to do a campus that now fully integrates in its full master plan build-out, academic, which is the teal color, with special program functions, which are restaurants and shops and so on, and student amenities, and housing, which is in the orange. To create a full, completely pedestrian campus, there's only parking under a raised portion of the central spine and the central quad. Everything else is only pedestrian, doesn't allow any cars in. We're actually building a rainwater treatment and collection system around that effectively acts as a moat so nobody can drive the moped into the campus. And to really create this kind of like integrated environment. And Vietnam, like Thailand, is one of the countries that are going to be really affected by climate change. It's a low river delta, rising sea level, more intense storm, all of these things, dramatic urbanization, all of these things have a huge impact locally. So from the beginning, the client was really interested in sustainability and allowed us to help them to formulate this in a way where we have very specific goals for being 100%, meeting 100% of our energy from renewable sources, dealing with all of our stormwater on site, using potable water only for the things we can't use non-potable water for, to really drive this project to be a model of how sustainability and campus development can work. And so this was on the master plan level introduced in diagrams and calculations, but in very specific master plan guidelines and language that were specific for the project, both in terms of energy, water. All of these things now have specific targets for the project. And it informed what we wanted to do on the landscape, because obviously water and stormwater management is a huge issue in this region and on a site like this. And so taking Cohen & Partners as landscape architect used a lot of these local precedents in terms of language to create a language of landscape that fundamentally defines the architecture, but is a functional landscape from a stormwater management standpoint as well. So we're now in phase one, really late. So phase one is the first 60,000 square meters of program. It's the first two dorms, an academic space in the core. But what's interesting is in order to build this and be true to our mission, we're actually building the entire stormwater management infrastructure, the central utility plant, for the future master plan, preserving sites for all of the future building, which I think is the real power here of a very developed master plan, is that we know what's going to happen in the future, and we can properly allocate the right resources at this point. And so now we're working our way through all of these nitty-gritty things where we say, what is the stormwater flow from the areas we're developing? How is this going to go through treatment basins into collection areas to actually create all of the water features and the irrigation and the landscape? How does this tie back into the building and our central energy plant? We're actually collecting all of our stormwater, centrally treating it so that we can reuse it, have a full understanding of what the water needs are in the project so we can really close the water circle to maintain our goals. Likewise, on the energy side. And the energy side is interesting because we have different program components that have very different functions. Academic space, social space, classrooms, dormitories. And so we're developing energy models for all of these strategies to meet our goal of being 40% below energy use before we then start layering in the renewables. And a key component here in this climate is to understand what is thermal comfort really. And so here in the dormitories, where we know that the majority of the population are going to be students coming from, I see Nari looking at the time, we're seeing students coming from rural neighborhood, the rural countryside in Vietnam. We understand that the understanding of thermal comfort is not, oh, I want to be in an air-conditioned space 24/7, but that you actually want to be in something that's climate appropriate. And so we now can model it. How many hours in the year is this comfortable? But then actually understanding when students are in the dorm rooms, how many hours are they going to be comfortable when they are in the dorm? And how can we manipulate this through window screens, shades, fans, to really drive a low energy strategy that's also really part of the place and encourages people to go outside and being in the social space because they don't constantly go back and forth between a transition of air-conditioned space and non-air-conditioned space. And even our main social space, which is the longhouse in the front, is going to be basically non-air-conditioned most of the time. It's going to have huge windows so we can cross-ventilate really big ceiling heights and big ceiling fans to allow this building to, for the majority of the year to be naturally ventilated. So obviously, shading strategies are a really important part here. And so once we've done all of this, we start thinking about where do we put photovoltaics on the campus and off campus to start meeting our goals. So this is where we are. We are also, in order to really demonstrate the commitment and showcase this to all stakeholder groups, we're going to both certify the entire master plan and the buildings through LEED, and then we're certifying through LOTUS, which is the Vietnamese green building system, the individual dorms, where that system is a better application. So again, trying to document this and communicate this back to the various stakeholders at various levels through certification. So I think this is a great example of how through integrated system analysis and long-term thinking, you can create something that will be sustainable in the landmark project. Now, finally, and I know I'm at my limits, I'm going to go really quickly, although that's maybe what a lot of people have waited for. I do think that while we can drive ourselves to be lower energy use throughout, I think we also mustn't forget that it's fundamentally about delighting people in great architecture. So one of the things that we've done recently is done more and more work where we basically brought landscape indoors for various reasons. Gardens by the Bay with Grant Associates and Wilkins Air Architects is the one that we finished 6-7 years ago. It's a really big landscape park. The idea here was to create two biomes in a large botanical garden as a signature project for Singapore. And the idea here was to create two biomes that are very different than your typical lush Singaporean climate, in that one of them was cold but moist, and one of them was cold and dry. So what it means is we needed to drop the temperature in these biomes from where Singapore typically is in terms of its warm and humid climate. Yet at the same time, we needed daylight for the plants to grow. And so here we had a situation where the horticulturists were intensely involved with telling us how much light do we need for the plants and what temperatures can they adopt. But from the beginning, the idea was this can't be, if this is about a landscape garden in Singapore, the garden city, this can't be an enormous energy hog. This needs to be part of the Marina Bay environment and sustainable. So we spent a lot of time analyzing how the building skin really modulates solar gain and how flexible it needs to be to do that. And so we know we have high solar gains on the outside. We modeled how that solar gain gets into the building, and even the design of the skin down to the mullion level was optimized because we knew that if we have large structure, that structure is going to cut down light to the plants that had trigger incident radiation numbers that we needed to achieve. So this is all about fully integrating a very detailed level of analysis, but then also working with the client. We understood that in Singapore, it's actually a wide degree of sky conditions where it's very bright or very cloudy. And so how do we get to the very high light levels that we need when we need them, but also be able to shade it once we've met what the fundamentally, once the plants have absorbed enough light that they need in order to meet their either their growing potential or their natural cycles. And so what this lends us to do is actually design a system that actively shades the glass domes when we don't need the light. So we have these large sails that can fall out of the structural ribs to basically let light in until the plants have satisfied their needs and then unfurl and shade the building so that we don't have excessive cooling demands. Then once we get into this, the goal was always to condition the spaces for the plants, but not this entire large volume, which for structural reasons has this large, like the large span and large height. So the goal was here to bring a lot of the energy in low, very low actually, to right to the plants, and the people use the active surfaces to cool buildings, cool people right next to the plants, so the people are comfortable, the plants get the temperatures, but the temperature at the top of the building stratifies. And it also meant that all of the mechanical systems are hidden. So you're in a building that basically is this almost invisible glass skin, yet it's a completely comfortable, cool climate in Singapore. And then quite differently, in the wet biome, the idea was to create this idea of a misty mountain, cold mountain. So we have a much higher element in the center of the biome. Same idea of controlling solar gain. But here we were much more concerned about how the heat rises in the biome, because now people will be at these higher elevations seeing the plants. So there was a lot of modeling about where do we introduce air at various levels? Will people and plants still be comfortable? And so that, in combination with the solar strategies, allowed us to maintain an architecture that's quite transparent, but again, introduces hidden in the plants, diffuser surfaces, and so on to maintain space condition. And so this building, I'm assuming some of you, or many of you might have seen it, created a great icon for Singapore at Marina Bay. But it is something that needs energy. And so here, the strategy was, and how can we meet that energy needs in the most sustainable way? And one of the things that Singapore has is lots of biomass, especially this client, which is the park, is actually responsible for the maintenance not only of the Gardens by the Bay Park, but of all the parks in Singapore. So we had large amounts of biomass that we could use, shred up, and basically use as a biomass boilers to generate heat without having to go to a fossil fuel. So this is all short carbon cycle emissions. And what we're getting to is a building that basically runs all of its cooling systems, which is the predominant energy use in this building, purely from renewable sources, whether it's biomass or a little bit from PV and solar thermal. We're actually producing excess power from this biomass strategy beyond what we need for conditioning. So this is something where, again, I think this idea that you can come up with a really wacko vision of gardens by the bay and super trees and biomes in a hot and humid climate and translate this through daring structural engineering and environmental engineering into a vision of sustainability that really creates an environmental, truly environmental experience, I think was quite exciting. And so they did this at Gardens by the Bay and then said, that's awesome, let's do it again. Now we're going to do it at the airport. Except Changi is quite different. So Jewel, which I'm sure you've seen in the media, has just opened. Changi is different in that it sits right in the center of the airport, so it's not part of a landscape park. It is actually an incredibly complex building, meaning it's 5 stories below grade of parking and infrastructure. Then it's shopping and convening spaces and hotel stacked above. But the idea was to give Changi a heart, a moment where a traveler can come and relax and be in an environment in Singapore while not being exposed to rain and being within a lush landscape. What was different here is here we had more flexibility on the planting. So here Peter Walken Partners were the landscape architects and Moshe Softy were the architects. So here, we didn't have to create an environment for the plants. The environment here is really for the people. We just needed to make sure that we get enough daylight in to make the plants grow. And so again, the idea was to create a skin that starts to mediate the amount of light that goes through. And so this is a complex, obviously complex curvature. It actually got more complex due to the fact that I'll talk about the waterfall feature in the center, but one of the key features of this project is that the airport tram that connects all of the terminals is going right through our site and kept going the entire construction period. So the entire building is built around an active train line that drives where the geometry is. So it made the geometry really complex because it's actually not a donut with a hole in the center, but it's a squished donut with an off-center hole. So for all of you kind of like computer geeks who like to do 3D geometry, that's a really interesting one. And so then you're going to figure out where do the plants want to be and how does solar and irradiation work over the dome so that we can then direct light really to where we want the plants and keep it out of social spaces. And so again, it's a lot of modeling on solar radiation that then resulted in an optimized frit pattern so that we can control solar gain for human comfort and for plant growth appropriately while reducing our energy needs beyond for what we need for the plants. And then we did basically the same conditioning strategies that we did in Singapore, in Gardens by the Bay, where we used a lot of radiant surfaces and embedded diffusers. But in a way, this is Gardens by the Bay V-point, like version 2, because in Gardens by the Bay, we very much designed for Western, because that was the most published information, Western expectations of air movement and air speeds and comfort. But what we realized is actually in Singapore, people are much more comfortable with higher air speeds and these temperatures because you want the cooling effect. And so it actually changed in detail where the diffusers went and how big they were and so on as a refinement on this. And so again, air is introduced through these cascading stairs that are planted, and there's a couple of big rises. All of this gets integrated where the majority of the building is then conventionally conditioned building underneath it. But keeping only this layer where people are conditioned was a key aspect of reducing energy use, so we don't have to worry or condition the rest of the building while being sure that we don't exceed top temperatures, at which point the glass might delaminate. And one of the key issues here is that the center feature of a falling waterfall, we were really concerned that the falling water, while it has a cooling effect, could also potentially disrupt this layering of heat. So there was a lot of modeling of droplet sizes and water flow and so on to be confident that this system would work in the integration with these very low energy HVAC strategies. So you see the grills embedded in the walkway, diffusers in the landscape, all of this to really gently condition a space that allows the plant. So once you're in the space, you have to look really, really hard between all of the greenery to see where the plants are. These are some of the early photos still, some of them still during construction, and some of the opening days. But it creates this incredibly lush and inspiring landscape. And it's actually one of these things where you can't really understand. Well, 1 second. So the other one is this waterfall feature is basically the idea is we're collecting all of the stormwater that falls on the roof. All of this water gets treated and reused in a central water feature that falls from the central ring down, gets collected, and so it becomes both a cooling feature and something that's visible, but it's fundamentally recharged through rainfall and over the course of the year. And so you then end up with this very dramatic feature in the center of the space. It's actually used as a projection surface as well. They have this system set up to actually project onto the waterfall. And it's really hard to understand the scale of this building unless you see it. So I know I'm way over time, but you got to watch 2 minutes of this, and then we're done. But this is, it's a building that is very simple on some level in terms of its shape, but the sheer scale of it is mind-blowing. Also, there was a lot of effort throughout the entire design process to build nurseries and grow the plant material. So once the building opens, this is the train line that stayed active the entire time throughout the construction. So that once you open the building, you can actually move in with mature plant material. Actually, the train was particularly fun because the train needs to go to two sets of sliding doors from the outside into the building. So there was lots of CFD modeling of how this piston effect of the train coming in and out would potentially affect airflow. And then also whether the movement of the train would actually disrupt the waterfall. So there's a lot of detailed modeling going on with this. But I think this is a project that I think speaks very much to the spirit that we are after. It's that great environmental architecture should have an architectural story that really inspires and delights people and makes people appreciative of the environment and nature and the condition that they're in, and it's like making them aware of temperatures and humidities and airflows and water while also really meeting performance requirements. So this just gives you, I think the plans are what gives you the scale of how big this thing is. And I encourage you all to see it when you have a chance. The beauty about it is that you can fly to Singapore. It's not the most environmental thing, but you can fly to Singapore, see it, and fly back. You don't even have to go to Singapore because it's right at the airport. But it's a stunning place that you can. There's actually even a canopy park where you can climb like in a playground through the canopy of the trees, and if you don't have vertigo, you can see deep down into the depths of this. But it's very much a result of all of the studies that we've done previously at Gardens, by the way. Here's the central water feature. So, cut this off. Anyway, so with this I want to close. Thank you so much for having me, and I hope you're going to have a fun conversation. Way over time.
Thank you, Nico, for such a detailed insight into the world of environmental design. It was very interesting to see the amount of research and modeling you have put for each project. To continue with our Q&A session, I would like to invite our moderator, Kunmalina Balasatian, onto the stage, please.
Hello again, Nico.
Hello.
Hi. It's really great to see you on this stage after 20 years, after taking that class together. And we took this building technology class, and now you are actually consulting the best and, you know, the top architects in the world on the subject. Yeah. Well, I'm still learning. You know, this is probably better than a lot better than the class we took. So thank you for that. That's very exciting. And I'm glad a lot of things came back. I was a bit worried about that. So I think the first question, I'm just going to go right in because we have 15 minutes.
Yes, I'm sorry to everybody with lots of questions. But
you know, you do have a lot of eye candy, and you do work for some really amazing, I mean, with some really, because you start from the beginning and you're like part of the design team from the start. So this is a fun presentation despite the subject matter that usually it's very dry because you've got all these amazing, amazing projects. So actually this job as an environmental consultant is really quite a fun one. You get to do many more projects, many different types, different everywhere in the world. So can you tell us a little bit about Atelier 10 and why is it 10 and not 9 or 11? Is it a good number in the UK? Lucky number?
So it's a question that gets often asked. I think it fundamentally comes out of a drunken night at a pub where our founder was close friends with Neil Thomas, who was the founder of Atelier One, which was a structural engineering firm in London. They're actually the ones who did the structure for Gardens by the Bay. And Neil convinced Patrick, our founder, to spin out on his own as an engineering firm. And it was very much in this idea of closely aligning structure, like an integration of structure, design, and in mechanical systems. And so it was a very ad hoc decision to
say. This was your pub conversation?
That conversation happened in a pub. And so it was like, we're going to go out, we're going to do this, and what's the easiest way to name the firm is you're going to go binary, you go 110 as the next one. But the other thing that was very important, and I think is very much the ethos of the firm, is that Patrick didn't want this to be about a signal or name. So he didn't want to be an over-arrow or a bureau-happled. But it was really about the teamwork and the integration both internally and with the partners. So it was very conscious not to choose an architectural and a name as a studio name, which has worked quite well.
Okay, that's a good story for a firm name. So this question actually comes from one of our guests, speakers from today. So I'm going to prioritize this question. How do we pay the true cost of a construction material? Extraction, manipulation, shipping, implementation, all these things are not part of the cost of a construction material right now. They are embodied energy in the material, though, right? Is that the right term?
Yeah.
Okay, so disassembly, upcycling, or waste management, these are probably some of the ways to do it.
Well, there's a larger discussion in our world whether we just need to have a carbon tax, and then the externality of carbon emissions that currently isn't included in the price of many of the things we consume. So the environmental impact of the things we do isn't really priced in a lot of our products. A carbon tax would do away with this. It would basically bake the cost of the entire environmental footprint into the material. A lot of economists agree that would be the best way. The downside is it's extremely hard, once you call it tax, to get voters to agree to it, which means you get politicians are very loath to adopt it. And so I do think we are now looking at a world where we either through regulatory requirements, we start pricing it in, or through transparency demand more action. And I think this is actually where we as architects can have a lot of impact, because we see this with some of our clients who take these goals seriously, who now go to their supply chain and say, I want to know what the carbon emissions of your product are. Tell me so I can make a decision. The moment you get this transparency, it is an impetus for firms to really do something and figure out where they can optimize. So I think we all need to ask for it. That's the key thing as a first step.
So we're actually going to make the price per square meter of our buildings much more expensive. Does that mean we're going to find less jobs?
No, I don't think that's the case. I think what's interesting is, I think there's a lot of opportunity for, I mean, if you think about the fact that we're going to renovate 50,000 people, 50,000 buildings in New York, there's actually a huge labor component that will happen in that world. But I do think we're going to shift costs. Right now, we pay over time for the energy that we use. And especially once energy prices are a true representation, that number is going to go up. So by shifting the cost from our operational payment to the quality of the building that we're building, I think we are not going to see a cost increase. We see this in a lot of our work, that the projects are not coming in significantly higher, at like in the low single digit of percentage for all of these energy things that we're doing, because a lot of the things stay the same. You still need to mobilize a construction site. You still need to have a guy hang sheetrock. A lot of the costs are not going to change. It's the tweaking of the performance that you can actually do if you do it smart at fairly low cost, especially if you do it in the way we approach it, which is to start from concept and not trying to fix something that fundamentally has gone wrong.
So I think this leads into another question I had from somebody here, that to convince a client who might not be ever thinking that they would need to spend a bit more money to have an environmental consultant. You know, already the architect's like so expensive, and now we have this. So do you have, this is kind of the argument that you go for, like how much you're actually going to save them. In the end, whatever they're paying for you is going to get saved in 5 years. Or
I think it's interesting. I mean, I think it's different. They're different drivers. We haven't had yet the performance contract where we said it pay us out of the savings of that we get you. Although we've recently worked on a large casino project where I wish we had done this, because then I would be much better off than I am right now. But I do think there are different drivers with different clients. Some clients want the differentiator, and so they want something that's different and they want special, and they're willing to engage with a different group of consultants for that. Some of them are doing it from a risk management standpoint. And I mean, the interesting thing about the regulatory environment changing is that a lot of the work that happens now is because the regulations require them to do it. So depending on where they are on the spectrum, there are different drivers for different clients. You've just got to figure out what the driver is to connect to them.
But by looking at your repertoire of work, you probably have some really important architecture firms who say, we're not going to work on this unless we have these guys on board, right?
I mean, we do a lot of our work, 80% of our work is repeat work with architects we've worked with before. Because fundamentally, a lot of this work involves some level of risk. You do something that you haven't done before, and risk is all about trust and relationship. And so if you have done a project, and so often it's an incremental change where you say, let's try something on this project, let's go to the next one. And so it's a relationship that you build and work with together. It also allows you in early design, when you need to make decisions really quickly, to come and develop a shorthand around certain aspects of how does a certain firm make decisions, what are the triggers. And so once you have that portfolio, it's easier for the architect to go and say, you hire me because I did these three buildings. I did all three buildings with this team. I want to bring my team in.
And look what I've done.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. So that's always good. So one of the things, I mean, you've thrown out a few really, really great keywords. One of the things I like to say in my own little practice here, because we deal with tropical, and thank you so much for talking about the tropical climate and how to make it, you know, energy efficient, which seems to have, there's so much less to find, you know, to research done on the tropical climate than, you know, it's so hard to find stuff on cooling. It's all about heating, how to save. So that, I learned a lot from that. But one thing that came up was the duck curve. So just to remind the audience, the duck curve is about storing your solar energy. So you have the solar, right? So you can talk about more about that, but I was somebody is wondering that if we're aiming to get from the duck to the snake curve, flat curve, investing more in battery bundle with PV is a great idea. But how do you convince the client to implement the battery storage strategy? And to add to that question is, are batteries efficient enough and cheap enough yet, and are they toxic when you have to dispose of them? So there's these issues.
They're definitely issues. I mean, I think batteries is one of these technologies where we are all watching technologies evolve while it happens. Because basically everybody right now, that's the holy grail. We're not going to get to electric cars without great advances in battery technologies. And a lot of these are happening. I think what's exciting to me is that in buildings, we need energy in different forms. And so there's battery technology for electrical storage that's definitely going to be on the table. And there's the question of, are you an early adopter and put it in your building, or is it going to happen on the utility scales, where the utility scale may be using different technologies, just use those on the grid level. I think we see a lot of that happens as these technologies become available. But one of the things that we also need in buildings is either heating or cooling, and that we can also store. And so we can do storage of chilled water or ice or hot water now in phase change materials or in ice. And so that is actually, in most cases, just water, and so it has no toxic implication. And we can do similar load shifts as well. So we're doing a big 1 million-plus square foot office building in New York City right now, where we basically run the chillers at the time when we have excess capacity to basically prepare our cooling and move our energy from day to night or where we need it. But not as electricity, but as heating and cooling.
So water is like kind of the low-tech battery pack.
It's thermal battery, yeah.
Right, thermal battery. So I'd like to go back to the whole tropical architecture. Are there any more questions? Because we have another 10 minutes. Can you write it down and send it over? Okay.
Sure.
If you can speak loud enough, we have a mic.
The one. Wait, you can see a lot of this in Singapore, where the climate is not so much different than Thailand, right? But back like 15 years or 20 years ago, you see a Bugis junctions where you cover it by the glass roof, and whether it's heavily aircons or something, people are comfortable in it. But if you go to Suvarnabhumi Airport, it's like halfly covered by glass, and it's still hot.
Yeah.
And again, you heavily act on it, right? So my question would be, what is the difference? Was it engineering differences or like?
So I don't.
Why can't we apply it in Thailand? Let's say.
Okay, so I don't know the first project you mentioned. I know the airport and the work that Transola has done on that, and I obviously know our project. Let me just preface this: a glass roof in a tropical climate, unless you have plants inside that need high amount of daylight, is a really bad idea. Don't do it.
Thank you.
So let's just be clear about this. Do not replicate Joule unless you have a need for a huge greenhouse that needs daylight for the plants. So I don't want to start, I really hope nobody starts a tropical typology out of Joule, because these are very unique, special projects, and a lot of energy goes into building them and then maintaining them. I do think the more appropriate form is actually a project we've done years before, which are the Esplanade theaters. So Esplanade theaters, we were hired for, it was one of the first projects that we attended as an international consultant.
That's the one in Singapore?
That's Singapore, that's the Durian.
The Durian, yes. The Durian.
And so the Durian actually started out as a glass bubble before we got involved. And what we then did is design a shading strategy that still preserved view, but effectively shaded the glass bubble. And so that is, I think that, if you want to do bubbly buildings with glass, that's, again, unless you have plants that need to live inside of it, that's a much better way to go. The other thing is it's incredibly difficult to overcome direct solar gain on a body unless you really blast the space with aircon. So what we've done at Gardens by the Bay and what we've done at Joule is either use secondary shading strategies. On Joule, there's actually areas that have shaded, like basically giant internal sails, umbrellas, actually the tree canopy of the trees to get you out of direct sun. And we use a lot of radiant surfaces to basically balance out the solar gain from the roof. But in a lot of the older projects that used a lot of glass, you basically had to rely on blasting people with a lot of air. And that is very quickly gets to comfort problems, which then means people dial down how much aircon they provide, which then means the space gets too hot. The airport, I think, is an interesting one here because it's a membrane roof. And I know that a lot of work was done with that membrane roof reflects the radiant floors and so on, but it becomes a finicky system from a control standpoint.
How about the pneumatic roof? What is that product called? It's like a cushion that they use in
ETF. ETF. Yeah.
But that's still kind of a glass house, right? But it reflects lots of the light out.
Well, if it's a transparent ETF, so for example, if you saw Gardens Joule, actually, the thing that's at the center of the waterfall, the donut, is a big ETFE cushion. So you can make a transparent ETFE roof that has some insulating properties. At the airport here, I think you have a mix of opaque and transparent. So the opaque one acts as a shade, but again, it doesn't have very good insulating properties. So once it heats up, it radiates a lot of the heat potentially down.
So I think this leads actually, I really appreciate Kai mentioning glass is not a good material for this climate, and we have these glass towers everywhere in Thailand and Southeast Asia and the whole tropical zone, actually. So when the modernists came up with the glass and steel idea, they weren't really thinking of us. They were like trying to keep warm, right?
Well, they weren't also really thinking about doing warm. They were happy about the fact that they could.
You can see out.
Yes, and you can do. There's a whole other architectural rationale behind it. But I do want to say that glass in itself is not a bad material for the tropics, because glass is actually ages quite well under rain and moisture conditions. It allows you great views in daylight, but unshaded glass is a problem here. And so I think what we tried to do on the Rajrami Tower is to effectively shade it through overhangs and fins and so on to preserve the view and then still use glass as a building material. The advantage you have here is that you don't have a lot of heat loss. So the problem we have with lots of glass in New York is that even if I shade it, I still lose a lot of heat through it in the winter. And that is very hard to overcome.
We don't have that problem.
You don't have that problem.
But so I still repeat myself. We are covered, the whole tropical zone is covered in high rises with glass without shading.
Yes.
Like, you know, facade, flat glass, which is what looks cool and what's done everywhere, and that's the technology. So that leads me into a question that I wanted to ask Kai, but my question didn't make it to the time limit. is, so you talked a little bit, you mentioned a type of wood that you use in one of the projects, mass, whatever.
Mass timber.
Yeah. So there's now a movement to actually make 200 meter high high-rises out of CLT, which is cross-laminated timber.
It's the same material.
Which is the same material. Do you have any more input on that?
Well, I think there's a lot of interest in using wood in buildings for the embodied energy reasons. Actually, the project that I think we both didn't show is Google London, which uses a lot of mass timber in terms of the floors and so on. There's some distinct advantages from embodied energy, just the kind of like the
and it's completely renewable because the trees that get planted for this purpose.
Yes, it's renewable material, so it's great. I think there are, and I think the structural issues we are overcoming right now, the biggest issue is often to get local planning approvals and code approval. So I've not seen anybody do a 200 meter tower yet. I know there's a lot of research in that. We were working on an 11-story residential building in New York, and the biggest challenge is actually, interestingly, the construction phase. Because once the building is built and the sprinklers are installed and the appropriate systems are in place, the buildings are actually quite resilient to fire, and the authorities are fairly okay with that. The challenge is the construction phase, when the systems are not installed and a lot of the things are open, and then a lot of the devastating fires that happen in wood buildings happen typically during construction. And so I think that's where there's a big change that needs to happen both on the code officials, the fire department, and the construction industry. I mean, we all know construction is not necessarily all the time the best run or operation. And so you got to be very careful in a wood building how you manage fire protection during construction.
Yeah, when you're saying that, I'm imagining this Notre Dame thing, you know, seeing like the whole, all the wood getting burned.
So it's a bad example. Notre Dame was a construction site. Actually, the McIntosh School in Glasgow that just burned a second
just time being restored, right?
Was in construction after its first fire when it completely burned down. So wood and construction is the wood and the construction phase is our biggest challenge right now. Actually, the rest of the stuff, I think there's a lot of work happening that it has overcome.
I think we're way over time. I'm very sorry. Any last questions, important questions? If not, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for
joining us today.
Next, I would like to invite ASA 2019 chairperson, Dr. Acharawan Jitarat, to present a gift of appreciation to Nico. Before we end the session, I would like to thank all the audience for your interest and participation today. Please do not forget to check out ASA Architectural Design Awards 2020 via ASA website. A special thanks for ASA and all supporting team, along with stage furniture support from Poom Furniture Design and OCSU. Now we would like to take a quick break. Our last session of ASA Forum speaker is from Studio, which will start here at 4 p.m. in this room. We hope to see you in the next session. Thank you.